Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch, and I'm here with Dr. Evelina Fedorenko, who's an associate professor at Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, and we're getting enthusiastic about how brains make language work. Hello, Ev.
Hi, Gretchen.
Hi, thank you so much for coming.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So we always start by asking our guests, how did you get into linguistics?
I liked learning languages when I was little. That was kind of my shtick. And I was in a school where English was started pretty early. And then my mom wanted me to be a citizen of the world. And so at age 9 or 10, I started learning French. And then eventually we added Spanish and Polish because I had some Polish ancestry, German, a couple others. And so I enjoyed that. I liked seeing patterns in languages.
This feels very relatable.
Yeah, but I didn't really know what to do with that. So I was growing up in Russia, I should say, and I knew that I wouldn't stay there in the long run, but I couldn't quite see yet how I could use all these languages in a professional way. Like, I didn't want to be an interpreter, and it just wasn't really clear to me what else I could do. And then when I started my undergraduate degree, I took a class in linguistics and then later in cognitive science and learned that you can basically study language and how we process language for a living. And so that's what I've been doing ever since.
Amazing. Yeah, I think I went through that. Oh, I like learning languages. So you're going to be a translator at the UN. And I was like, oh, no. But what else is there?
That's right. Yeah.
So how did that get you into your current research topic?
Well, I started out as an undergrad researcher doing some behavioral experiments and then realized that I kind of want to do this for a living. So I applied for graduate programs and I came to MIT. I was a grad student here as well. That was in 2002. And I initially wasn't sure exactly what kind of questions I want to pursue. But then gradually I got really interested in the relationship between language and other cognitive capacities. So questions like, do we use the same mechanisms, the same neural machinery to understand language and to do math or to process structure and music or something like that? And for those kinds of questions, behavioral experiments are just not, cannot directly answer them. And the best tool that exists for answering these questions is functional MRI, where you can directly have people do a language task and say a music task or a language task and some logical reasoning task and see if the same brain areas are activated. And so I started working with Nancy Kamwisher, first developing robust tools for finding language responsive areas in individual brains. And then over the next, I guess, 15 years or so, trying to understand what it is that these regions are doing and how they relate to other systems that we have in our brains.
So let's say you're trying to study this with a behavioral task. What does a behavioral task look like?
You mean trying to understand the relationship between language and other things?
Yeah. So if you're trying to compare language and music or language and math or something, what would you even be trying to do?
So there's generally two behavioral approaches that you can use for these kinds of questions. One is called a dual task approach. So you're trying to get people to do two things at once. And you're trying to see whether the difficulty that you get when you're doing these two things is above and beyond the additive difficulty of each of the tasks. Okay?
Okay. So this is sort of like rubbing your head and patting your stomach at the same time. If this is hard, it's because they're both movement tasks and they're in different directions.
Competing.
But the idea is you're trying to like sing a song and also do some math problems at the same time. And if this is really hard, then maybe that tells you something.
Exactly. And you always would need control conditions and all sorts of things to make reasonable inference. So that's one thing. And another thing you can do is relying on individual differences. So you can look across a bunch of individuals and say, okay, are people who are good at math as measured by some, you know, battery of tasks or whatever, are also good at music? And again, you'd want to control for some basic general goodness of brains. People vary in how good their brains are, how quickly they work. Yeah. But above and beyond some kind of, you know, general shared variance, is there a meaningful relationship between, say, how good your linguistic ability is and your musical ability? So these kinds of things.
But these feel kind of indirect.
Exactly. And for individual differences, you just also need vast samples to draw meaningful inferences. And it's painstaking and the tasks are sometimes tricky to kind of get just the right difficulty so you could get some variability. So some people are better and worse, but yeah.
Right. Because if everyone's getting 100% on the task, then that's not going to tell you anything about
exactly
what some people are better at than others.
That's right. Yeah.
So this seems very complicated. So instead, we stick them in the brain. We make them do some math. We make them listen to some language. We make them listen to some music or something.
That's right.
And then we see which bits light up. And there's a couple different ways we could look at them in the brain. Like, there's different types of machines to do studies in. The two that I'm most familiar with are MRI and EEG.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit about what the difference is between those and why you'd pick MRI for your particular type of studies?
Yeah, sure. So EEG is basically recordings of electrical activity from the scalp.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a signal that is very temporally precise. So you know kind of millisecond by millisecond how these very small voltage changes happen. But you don't really know where the signal is coming from.
So this is the one, when you see pictures of it, you see people with a sort of like skull cap on their heads with all the little,
little nodes,
and electrodes, like you're in
yes.
a scientific experiment. And so because your brain makes electricity as you're thinking, and so if you can track that electricity, but very imprecisely because you're doing it through like your hair and your scalp and your skull and all of this like layers of, you know, fluid and stuff.
Exactly. Yeah.
And so you like kind of know it's happening maybe in the left and the front.
Exactly. That's kind of the very coarse level. Yeah. And so for questions like do two abilities draw on the same resources, this is just not good enough.
Right. Okay.
Even though people had tried to use it in those ways, but I think it's limited. And so in fMRI, instead, we basically take images of the brain, and we can take anatomical images, which are just static, detailed images of people's anatomy, and takes a few minutes. You can take a really good image. But of course, what's more valuable to people who are interested in brain function are functional images. And there, we can take very precise images
mm-hmm.
because we're trying to take them fast enough to kind of measure changes over the course of seconds. That's about as good as we can get in most circumstances with fMRI. So we take a very coarse image every 2 seconds, typically in most typical sequences. And then we try to look at, basically analyze brightness levels, which reflect changes in blood flow. And through this general approach, we can, with very high precision, figure out where exactly in the brain are these changes happening. So which are the bits of the brain that are working harder when you're, say, solving a math problem or listening to a piece of music.
And so the MRI, it's the same machine. It's just how many pictures you're taking, how quickly between functional and the regular MRI.
It's different sequences. That's right.
And you go into the massive tube, which is a big magnet, and the magnet is effectively measuring the iron in the blood in your brain that's being used more in some areas than in others.
Exactly, exactly. So when your, you know, some brain area works, cells fire, and to fire, cells need glucose and oxygen. And so if some area is working hard, there's going to be an increase in blood flow to replenish the supplies that have been used up, and we're detecting these changes.
And then you can sort of see relatively fine-grained where the blood is going. So if you want to see where stuff is in the brain, you want to use an MRI.
Exactly, yeah.
Like the EEG gives you stuff down to like the millisecond, but the MRI is like, okay, well, every 2 seconds, that's as close as we can get. Because there's always a sort of trade-off between how fine-grained a location you can figure out and how fine-grained a time thing you can figure out.
That's exactly right.
Maybe someday we'll come up with a technology that lets us do both, but that doesn't exist right now.
Yeah. No, there are people who are combining EEG. They actually have people wear these caps and scan them at the same time. I have yet to see the use of this combined technology to answer some deep question. Like, mostly it seems like a technical feat to deal with all the like artifacts that you get from these channels. But I haven't seen like any really cool discoveries from the combination of the two methods. There is another method which is very limited in the population that we can test with it, but mm-hmm. it's intracranial recordings.
Okay.
So occasionally when people undergo surgery, we can get access to the brain directly, and then we know exactly where we are, and we can get very fine time resolution.
But it's a little bit harder to get people to undergo surgery, like
of course.
A study in your lab.
No. It's only for people who clinically need this, which is either like when they have drug-resistant epilepsy or when they have a tumor, or mm-hmm. when they need like a deep stimulation device implanted, as in cases of, you know, like Parkinson's disease or something like that.
So if people are already having brain surgery for some other reason, then you can say, well, let's figure out where your language center is.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This brings us to this question of sort of where is your language center and what you normally find in people's brains when it comes to where language is?
Sure. First, I think it's sometimes helpful to just kind of draw the distinction between speech and language, because I don't know if that often comes up in your podcast. I've heard some episodes, but not all of them. But so there is the acoustics of speech, or for sign language, there is some visual basic processing, or for reading, right? There's also some perceptual, like visual cortex has to recognize the letters. And there is specialized mechanisms for this perceptual analysis. But then after the information is analyzed through these perceptual mechanisms, we have to interpret the signal, right? So basically, once we kind of extracted the sequence of words, we're trying to understand what is the meaning of the sequence of words. And that's the system that we've primarily studied. So this is a set of brain areas that in most people are in their left hemisphere. There's some frontal components, so the front of the head and the side of the head and the temporal lobe. And those regions basically work whenever you understand language, regardless of whether you read it or heard it, or if somebody signed it to you, if you're a speaker of a sign language. And it also works when you produce language. So when you're converting a thought into a sequence of words for somebody else to understand. So it seems like the system is basically storing our knowledge of language. And so we can use it to convert from thoughts into messages, or kind of decode messages that we hear or read.
Yeah, and that's really important, because you don't want to be like, oh, we found language. It turns out it's actually just the part that's involved in processing the sound of the human voice.
Exactly.
And we don't use it at all for reading, or signers don't use it. But if you can find something that's in common between all of these different formats, then it's like, this is the bit that's the core thing that we think is actually doing language, irrespective of what modality it exists in.
That's absolutely right.
And you said that most people have the language processing bits are on the left-hand side. And I remember hearing about this when I was about 13 and I was sort of newly getting into linguistics. Mm-hmm. And I learned that it was basically all right-handed people that have their language hemisphere on the left side of their brain. Because when it comes to like physical control of the body, the left side of the brain controls the right-hand side and the right-hand side controls the left. And then still a lot of left-handed and ambidextrous people also have their language hemisphere on this left side. But then there are a few of the left-handed and ambidextrous people who process their language on the right-hand side or on both sides. And I've always sort of wondered, hey, I'm left-handed. Am I part of this anomaly group? And so when I was an undergrad, you know, I did a lot of psych studies or whatever, because they'd pay you $10 and it was, you know, sort of a good deal, and I'd buy lunch. Yeah. But I always got excluded for the brain scan ones, the fMRI ones, because they were like, oh, we're not doing left-handed people because you have this massive confound of you might have your language hemisphere on the wrong side. I was like, yes, that's what I want to know. So I was really excited that you agreed to let me come into your MRI machine and find out, you know, for once and for all, for no practical purpose, but like, I would like to know, and also then my data can be added to your studies, which side my language hemisphere is on. So we have those results.
Yeah, we do. So we have those results from when we scanned you.
Oh, so this is my brain.
This is your brain. And your language system is very left lateralized, as in most people.
So I'm not a special person. I am just like everyone else.
Well, you're a very special person. Just not for this reason.
So I'm seeing these sort of black and white scans, and then some areas that are really lit up in red and yellow, and the lit up bits are sort of in the left hemisphere mostly, and they're in this kind of V shape around the side sort of where my ear would be.
That's right.
Cool. And I mean, obviously the colors chosen are sort of arbitrary, but it's something that's sort of lit up.
Of course, yeah. And so when we show people, like when we look at language system activations, this is based on a contrast between people processing language. Sometimes we use auditory stimuli, sometimes we use written stimuli. Like I said, this system doesn't really seem to care one way or the other. And then we compare the response during the language condition to a control condition, where in terms of the perceptual properties, the stimulus is similar, but it doesn't have any meaning or structure in it. So for example, you did a task where you read sentences as opposed to sequences of non-words. So you just kind of hear, you know, floor, blicket, something, right? Like, and though you can't make sense of them, but they kind of sound speech-like. And so we subtract that from the language responses, and then we get these regions that work more.
And so we don't want to just have the bit that's lit up when I like am reading anything that looks like a shape on a white square or something like that.
That's right.
So I'm also seeing here that there are some bits in the right hemisphere that are lit up, not quite in this nice V shape, but there's still some bits that are lit up. Can you tell me anything about that side?
Yes. So in fact, in the majority of people, left lateralized people, there is some response in the right hemisphere as well. Mm-hmm. And there's still a lot of debate about how exactly right hemisphere regions contribute to language processing. We're trying to evaluate some of those ideas, but in the vast majority of people, there is some response,
okay.
Some like nice replicable response. It's usually weaker. So I also have a graph that shows you how much activity those different regions show.
Ah.
And this is responses now to those two conditioned sentences and sequences of nonwords. And you can see that the dark bar, the sentence response, is much higher, like twice stronger in the left hemisphere, but there's still a response in the right hemisphere.
Yeah, and like that's still a stronger response in the right hemisphere compared to the non-words.
Exactly.
Like mm-hmm. maybe twice as much a response to the non-words, yep. as to the words themselves. So obviously I want to know this for personal gratification, but like the finding that, you know, most people's language is processed on the left is something that I read about when I was mm-hmm. 13. So it's kind of old news when it comes to, okay, which side is language on? What are you trying to study that's sort of a deeper version of that question now?
Well, there's still a lot of interesting puzzles. So one thing that we still don't know as a field is whether having language be atypically lateralized, so right lateralized or bilateral, present in both hemispheres, whether that makes you in some way worse at language.
Oh, okay.
We don't know that. So there's mixed evidence so far, but I think it also, this question hasn't been investigated in large enough populations and with sufficiently sensitive tests. Both neural in the brain and behavioral tests. So I think that question is still a little bit in the open. We've spent some time trying to develop tasks that would allow us to get variability in the typical neurotypical population in terms of their language skills.
Mm-hmm.
Because most tests that exist to assess people at the individual level come from either the developmental literature or the literature on individuals with language disorders like aphasia, you know, following stroke or something like this. And so if we take those tests and administer them to college undergraduates, they're all perfectly accurate, like you were saying. And so then we can get that variance. And so we've been trying to develop sensitive tests of language comprehension and production to try to see if we can then relate that variability to how lateralized their responses are. So that's all work in progress.
So if I had turned out to have language on sort of both sides or on the right-hand side, then you'd be like, ah, now we can use this to see what your responses are like to these kinds of things.
Exactly. We now know, we as a field and my lab specifically, we know that it doesn't seem like you can't have a perfectly functional language system in the right. So at least in cases where okay. you have extensive early damage in the left hemisphere, so that happens sometimes when you have early stroke as a child or even prenatally,
mm-hmm.
these individuals will typically end up with a perfectly functional system in the right hemisphere. And we've been working with this interesting individual who was born without her left temporal lobe.
Wow.
And so
okay.
her system is fully right lateralized and her language is great. She, even with like all the most sensitive tests we've tested, and she didn't know that she was missing her left temporal
wow.
lobe until she was about 20 something.
Oh my gosh. So she just misses this massive part at like the front left
yes.
bit, sort of above the ear of the brain. And nobody noticed because
no.
the rest of her brain just took over.
Yeah, she's, you know, she has an advanced degree, she's very smart, and we're kind of growing that line of work. And that suggests that from early on, the two hemispheres are kind of equipotential, as people, sometimes a term that people will use, either can develop a language system. Now, for some reason, right, in most people, it still ends up on the left. So something
yeah.
about that bias is making it advantageous to have it there.
And this sort of made sense to me when I was thinking about, okay, well, right-handed people, you know, maybe it's because they mm-hmm. use the right-handed side more. And so the, you know, something to do with maybe writing and language, although, of course, there's
That's
lots
right,
of language
yeah.
that isn't writing as well, which made it fascinating for me from a left-handed perspective of like, okay, well, then logically I should be using the right hemisphere. And yet still most left-handed people have it on the left as well, which
That's right.
is sort of the puzzle that I find interesting.
Yeah.
So are you trying to scan a lot of left-handed people because the odds that they're going to have some other sort of lateralization thing are higher or...
Yeah, I mean, it's something, we're not explicitly doing this right now. There may be a project that will start on that, but mostly we've been focusing on other kinds
okay.
of questions. Like, yeah, there's so many questions to ask. And I usually try to keep my lab relatively small so I can work closely with all the people in the lab as opposed to letting it kind of become hierarchically structured, which is just inevitable if your lab grows enough. And so we're focusing on other, yeah.
Yeah. So what kinds of questions are you trying to answer now?
Well, so one question that we've tackled among the first ones is the relationship between language and thought.
Okay.
And we found across multiple approaches, but fMRI prominently, that the regions in your brain, so these regions you were just looking at in this graph that work really hard when you understand or produce language, they don't work at all when you're doing math or solve logical problems or think about other people's mental states. So the system is very, very strongly selective for processing linguistic information.
Even though you can use language when you're doing math, or you could use language when you're thinking about other people's mental states.
You could.
Like, you could talk about other people's mental states, or you can talk about math, but that's different.
That's right, yeah. So language and thought have historically been conflated in all sorts of contexts, because, of course, how people speak and what they say is our prime source of evidence for what's going on in their mind, right? Like, it's a reflection.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah,
we can
yeah.
evaluate people how well they think by how they structure their linguistic utterances. But it turns out that the mechanisms that we use for those two things are completely non-overlapping. And in fact, perhaps the most compelling evidence that's complementary to fMRI comes from patients with what's known as global aphasia.
Okay.
So this is severe, severe damage to the language system. So typically due to a very large stroke that happens in this large artery that supplies this kind of frontal and temporal cortex. And so these people basically can't produce, can't understand anything. And yet they can do math and solve Sudoku puzzles and do all sorts of sophisticated reasoning. And so this is kind of this old, you know, centuries old question about language and thought, with a lot of theorizing and a lot of strong claims about how you need language to think complex thoughts. And it turns out that you really don't. So that's one big thing we've figured out.
So how would you go about studying that in an fMRI machine? Can you do a Sudoku? They can't really write.
Yeah, you can get them to do all sorts of... I mean, we haven't looked at Sudoku puzzles specifically, but basically, yeah, you put them on the scanner just like we did with you. We find their language regions, and then we also ask them to do some non-language tasks, like solve some math problems or do a hardworking memory task. Like, I think you did a spatial memory task as one of the tasks we used.
Yeah, I did one where I looked at a bunch of blue squares. I guess this is also the point to say that I did another interview with Saima Malik Morileta, who is the PhD student and the technician who ran me through all of these tasks, and we broke down all of the tasks in detail and sort of what I was looking for in each of the tasks and what I was looking at. And that is a bonus episode, which you can get access to at patreon.com/lingthusiasm. So you can see the details about what I did in the machine and what it was like in the machine there. But returning to this question of, yeah, what are you trying to look at? How do you test people reasoning about other people's mental states in a machine?
That's a good question. So there is a number of paradigms that exist. That one standard one is actually a verbal paradigm, but of course it's verbal in both conditions. So if you find difference, it's not due to language processing. But a common contrast that people use is processing little stories, little vignettes about thinking about somebody else's mental state, which is now incorrect.
Okay.
So for example, Gretchen thought that Ev had put her computer on this shelf or something like this, or Gretchen saw Ev put this somewhere here, and then Gretchen went away, and then I moved it.
And then I come back in. Okay, yeah, I think I've encountered this as like the Sally Ann task or something, which they do on children.
Exactly, exactly right. And then there is like a control version where there's no mental states involved, but there's still a difference between some representation of reality and reality. So it's known sometimes as the false photograph condition. So for example, you know, I took a picture of Gretchen's house when I was visiting her last year. Since then, she added a whole other level, and now the house is, you know, three stories tall, right? So there's my representation, my picture that I took, and reality, and they're different. And so in terms of the structure of the task, it's similar to thinking about somebody else's state, which differs from reality, but there is no mental state as such. And so that contrast gives you so-called theory of mind region. So there's a professor at MIT here in the same department, Rebecca Sachs, who has discovered this brain system and has been characterizing it for the last couple of decades, I guess.
In terms of what's involved when you're thinking about other people's states of knowledge.
Yes, exactly. And so that system seems distinct from the language system quite strongly.
Right, because I was thinking, how are you going to try to tell people about people's mental states without using language? But if you just use language in both conditions...
That's right. Or you can also show people videos, you know, silent films. We'll make all sorts of rich inferences about what people are thinking from what they're doing, even if there's no language at all. And so there is actually a version of this task that our lab and Rebecca Sachs's lab has been using based on just watching kind of silent animation films and then contrasting responses to when you have little clips which invoke you thinking about others' thoughts and beliefs and so on, compared to some control clips where there's maybe some social interaction, but there's no real kind of thinking of, you know, what am I thinking that Gretchen is thinking right now?
Right. Okay. And those don't seem to involve the language part.
No.
At all.
Yeah.
Because I was thinking, you know, okay, put me in the machine, you know, tell me to think about some stuff, you know, okay, what do we know from this? But you have this sort of very controlled environments where like, okay, you're figuring what people are thinking and what mental states are the people in the video.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. So yeah, so that's one thing we learned is that the language system is quite specialized for language processing. And then we've also been doing a bunch of stuff kind of diving into this system and trying to see like do different parts of that system. Like you saw that there's quite a few regions, right, that are active when we process language. Like do different regions process different aspects of language? Like is there a region that maybe processes linguistic structure and some other region that processes words? And that turns out not to be the case. From what we can tell from many dozens of experiments across our group and other groups, it seems that this distinction between word meanings and linguistic structure is not realized in terms of like a spatial separation into distinct regions. So it seems the very same regions that care about structure in language also deeply care about meanings of individual words.
There's a certain level of specialization in terms of like this area is used for visual language or this area is used for auditory language, something. But apart from when it comes to processing different types of meaning, like are there any regions that do specialized things there, or is it like we just don't know, or there's so much individual variability?
No, it's a good question. I mean, so the language system is specialized for language relative to all sorts of other things, right? Non-linguistic things. But in terms of the divisions within the language system, it's been hard to find those. So people have made claims that some parts of the system do, you know, there is a very strong claim from a few groups over the years that some subset of the system is specialized for syntactic processing, structure processing in language. So figuring out the dependencies between words and relatively insensitive to what, you know, what table means. But it seems that with robust enough methods, you find that that distinction is just not there. So it looks like it's a distributed processing of both syntactic components of language and word meanings.
Right. So being able to pin down like, okay, not only like this is where like the specific word table is stored, but like this is my dictionary where all of the meanings are stored. And this is my grammar where all of the relationships of like, here's what verbs do. Here's what nouns do.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. That doesn't.
Yeah, like this is how linguists like to organize their writing, but it's not necessarily what the brain is actually doing internally, which is sort of disappointing because it'd be nice if we'd stumble on the right thing the first time.
Yeah, that's right. But I think, you know, in a lot of, as I'm sure you know, in a lot of linguistic traditions, the grammatical information is actually very deeply tied to meanings of particular words. So it's not this kind of very abstract level where, you know, a sentence is made up of a noun and a verb, but instead there's very particular combinatorial constraints of how each word combines with other kinds of words.
Yeah, maybe it's something where, okay, so you need to know for the word eat specifically that you can say I eat, and you can also say I eat a sandwich, but for something like
devour,
I devour a sandwich, but I devour by itself doesn't work, even though
that's
eat
right.
and devour otherwise mean the same thing.
Very similar. That's right.
So you can't just have sort of one abstract thing. You have to be thinking about it at every individual word. What does it do with relation to the grammar?
Yeah, that's right.
Cool. So you're also looking at stuff to do with multiple languages.
That's right. We are. We are very interested in how individuals who speak many languages, two or more languages, represent and process those languages. And that, of course, has been a question of interest for many years. I kind of got into this work originally through work on polyglots, so individuals who learn, you know, sometimes many dozens of languages.
Yeah.
So we had a project, this line of work that I kind of got involved in accidentally. I just had somebody contact me and say, you know, I have a teenage child who has learned, you know, like 26 languages and he keeps learning them. Would you be interested in scanning them? And, you know, it's like, yeah, we can look at that. That sounds interesting. Cool. Yeah. And at that time, I didn't really know if we're going to just do this kind of as a one-off thing or really go into this line of work, especially because it's, you know, there's not many polyglots, right? It's a pretty rare population. Mm-hmm. But we brought him in and we scanned him. And then one thing I noticed is that, so he's a native English speaker, he's American. And when we looked at his responses during his native language processing, his language regions looked like they were not working very hard. They looked smaller and they weren't very active.
Hmm.
I was like, well, that's interesting.
Because you might think, oh, well, like, you know, you're using language regions a lot of the time. You got this big buff language region. Like,
yeah.
If I use my shoulder muscles a lot, they get bigger, you know?
That's absolutely right. And so I was like, oh, well, you know, maybe just something. I mean, we scanned them on a couple different sessions and we saw that it's like a replicable thing. So like how big your language mm-hmm. regions are is actually quite stable within people.
Okay, interesting.
You know, but I didn't really know what to make of it. Yeah, and then I had a postdoc who is now a faculty in Canada and Carleton, Alessia Shurovlev. And when she was here, she was interested in multilingualism. And she kind of found a couple other polyglots and scanned them. And then she kind of kept finding them and we kept scanning them. And so eventually we had like a sample of, you know, on the order of 20 people. And it turns out that this result, this smaller language regions, is a real thing.
Like, oh,
in polyglots compared to monolinguals and bilinguals, they have a smaller language system. And the way that we kind of interpreted this as greater efficiency, like your language system doesn't have to work as hard, perhaps because you're training it so much by learning all these different languages. But we also don't know, maybe their language system is different from the start and without doing like longitudinal work.
Yeah, so ideally you'd want to study somebody who, you know, starts out speaking one or two languages and then they sort of keep acquiring more throughout their life and see, like, do their language centers get smaller as
yes.
they use them more? Or do they already start out smaller and this gets creates a sort of predisposition
right.
to becoming a
yes.
polyglot mm-hmm. because they're already more efficient at it? Because, like, anecdotally, I feel like some people have an easier time in language classes, and I've never quite been sure why that's the case.
You know, that's absolutely right. There's definitely variability there, but it's also, like, people for whom it comes easy, they're a pretty heterogeneous population.
Okay.
So different things, different aspects of language seem to be easy for different people.
Mm.
So some people are like really good imitators. So you can tell them a sequence of sounds in any language totally unfamiliar to them, and they can repeat it beautifully. Some people are just really good at learning words, like they hear a word, they just don't forget it.
Mm-hmm.
And some people are really good at like deciphering kind of grammatical patterns, like how words combine and how they agree and all that stuff. And so it would be really nice to try to like unpack this and see if these different kind of linguistic talents, if you wish, are actually meaningfully different. For now, all we had
earlier we were like, oh, well, you know, it doesn't seem like there's one area in the brain that does words and one area that does grammar, but it does seem
right.
like there are some people who are really good at words and some people who are really good at grammar, who are really good at sounds.
Yeah,
it's hard to say what that is.
That's right. Like, it's not incompatible with not having a spatial separation within the system. It could be like, you know, maybe your language system is more strongly tied to your memory mechanisms or something like that.
Right. Or like, these things are all working together in your brain to do X.
Yeah.
Or these things are all working mm-hmm. together to do Y within that. I might venture to guess that there might be a higher proportion of Lingthusiasm listeners who might be polyglots. Are you still doing this study? If people are polyglots
yeah.
and they're in the Boston area?
That'd be great. Yeah, we've been scanning people here in Boston.
If people want to come in and get their brain scanned because you speak several languages, they can get in touch.
They should get in touch, yeah.
Great, we'll link to that in the description. And you guys tested me for English and French because those
That's
are the languages
right.
that I sort of operate in the most, even though I have sort of smatterings of linguistic knowledge and other things.
Yeah, that's right.
Can you tell me anything about what I'm doing for French?
Yeah, so your language system works when you process French, and it
Great.
Actually works. It actually
My
works
neighbors in Montreal will be relieved to hear that.
That's right. And it actually works a little bit harder compared to English. So
okay.
in this graph I'm showing you here, so this is how much it works when you process French. This is how much it works when you process English.
Okay, so those are sort of big bar lines, and the English uh-huh. one's like halfway up, and the French one's like three quarters of the way up.
That's right. And then there's a couple of control conditions. So if you may remember, you heard these kind of things, you know, we call them like quilted or textured speech. I mean, so it kind of sounds like speech, but you can't really make sense of it. It's kind of like really muffled and degraded. And then
uh-huh.
a couple of unfamiliar languages, which typically will elicit some response in people. So you're not familiar. So this is Basque and Tamil, which I don't think
yeah,
you have
I don't speak either of those.
With.
No.
And so those are lower than either of the languages that you speak. And there's also interesting, so Saima Malik Moraleda, who you talked to as well, so she's been noticing that in some bilingual and multilingual people, responses to unfamiliar languages seem stronger than in people who are monolingual.
Okay, so like you're trying to parse them even though you don't actually know what's going on.
Exactly. So you may have some kind of generally increased sensitivity to kind of trying to decipher something from linguistic utterances if you're linguistically attuned.
Yeah. I noticed when they were playing for me the Basque and Tamil, I was thinking, oh, how interesting. I don't think I've heard, you know, a passage in either of these languages that's this long before. I wonder if I can figure out, you know, what the phonology of them is, you know, what sort of sounds they have in comparison to other languages I know. And so I was kind of trying to go into language processing game. I wonder if that's something that you could train people to do with practice, or if
don't know, we haven't tried. I'm not aware of anybody who tried, but it's possible.
I mean what makes some people learn more languages than others, and also could any of this help someone learn a language if they're, because this is a difficult task for a lot of people trying to learn a language in adulthood. Is there anything that could make it easier for them to do it, although I guess that's very early stages?
Right. I mean, yeah, so far the best advice we can give is just, you know, do it earlier because it does seem...
Go back in time and tell your parents.
Exactly. Or do it for your kids or something.
Thank you so much for coming on the podcast. And if you could leave people knowing one thing about linguistics, what would that thing be?
That's a very good question. I mean, I think I would probably emphasize this result that I briefly talked about, that language is not the same thing as thought. Even though sometimes intuitively it feels like we're talking to ourselves all the time, turns out that that's even not a universal. Some people don't feel like they have a voice in their heads. And some people who do a lot of thinking about, for example, math, some professional mathematicians will say that when they get this voice, it kind of interferes with their thinking.
Ah.
So the thinking that happens in your brain doesn't happen in the same system that you use to understand language and to produce language. Yeah, and I think that's important to know. So even though people sometimes have very strong intuitions about language being really a key part of complex thinking, that just doesn't seem to be empirically true.
That's really interesting. Thank you so much. For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, Kiki Booba notebooks, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet. Lauren tweets and blogs as Superlingo. You can follow our guest, Ev Fedorenko, on Twitter at Ev_Fedorenko, and her website is evlab.mit.edu. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to an extra Lingthusiasm episode to listen to every month, plus our entire archive of bonus episodes to listen to right now, at patreon.com/lingthusiasm, or follow the links from our website. Have you gotten really into linguistics and you wish you had more people to talk with about it? Patrons can also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans. Plus, all patrons help keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include a live Q&A episode about swearing, a chat about the many uses of like, and a behind-the-scenes look at what it was like inside the MRI machine doing language studies. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We also really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone in your life who's curious about language. Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gaughan. Our senior producer is Claire Gaughan. Our editorial producer is Sarah Dopierella. Our production assistant is Martha Sutsui Billens. And our production manager is Liz McCullough. Our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic!